everyone's hearing declines as we age. There's always this notion that, well, if everyone's hearing gets a little worse as we age, so what? It's just getting older. It doesn't really matter. And I thought about my clinical experiences. I thought about my grandmother's experiences. It really didn't seem like it was true, but there's no literature studying hearing loss in adults, older adults. It was just always this assumption that how could it be important if it's something that everyone develops?
I would love for you to tell us what the latest data shows as far as hearing loss and cognitive decline in dementia.
The ACHIEVE trial, which is a cute acronym for the Aging Cognitive Health Evaluation Elders Randomized Trial, is basically testing this very idea. If we think that hearing loss is indeed linked to dementia through these pathways, does that mean, in fact, if you actually, quote unquote, treat hearing loss? Half people got hearing intervention, other people half got a control intervention. After 10 years, that trial resulted out last year and it was published in The Lancet in July 2023. Lo and behold, within 3 years, hearing intervention can reduce that rate of cognitive decline by about 48%. There's now a definitive randomized trial is exactly what we're seeing, which makes it really exciting. I came across a paper, it was in 2010, I came across a paper, and the paper was all the way back, Dean, from 1989. It's crazy. It was a 21-year-old paper, 100 cases of people with dementia. There appeared to be this clear relationship between level of hearing loss, per se, and the odds of having dementia. You think it would have caused a stir.
Yeah.
The idea that hearing loss may be a risk factor for dementia that may be treatable from my point of view, right? That makes it very exciting. Amazingly, Dean, from 1989 to which was topical in 2010, there was really maybe a handful of papers ever looked at it. In 2010, 2011, we published Baltimore Longitudinal Study of Aging. That was the first time it had ever been confirmed that hearing loss in a prospective fashion was linked with greater risk of dementia.
As we get older, we have loss of parts of this range.
Yeah. When we talk about age-related hearing loss, what we're really talking about is the cochlea that's responsible for sensory neural hearing. Those cells, again, that detect that fluid motion wave and then that convert that fluid motion wave into electrical signal. People begin losing hearing at the higher frequencies first, and that just has to do with where those cells are located in the inner ear. We say the inner ear is like tonotopically organized, or the keys of a piano.
Yeah.
And it happens that the keys of the piano, the inner ear that deal with more high frequency sound, are more susceptible to damage over time. So classically, we'll begin losing those higher frequencies first before you begin losing some of those lower frequencies. It's not that you can't hear, really. It's more that the inner ear is sending a slightly more garbled signal to the brain. So imagine playing the chord on a piano,
yeah,
right? You play a chord and it all, your brain gets it all at one time, right? But that chord is actually made of all these different frequencies and intensities, I think. So if you're missing some of those, that chord that reaches your brain is a little more fuzzy, right?
Yeah.
So that's basically what's happening as we develop quote-unquote age-related hearing loss, is that chord, per se, is not being fully transmitted to the brain with high fidelity, so it sounds garbled, basically. This is something that's really exciting, Dean, that I've been working on for a couple of years, too. The Hearing Number Initiative. With this app on an Android or iOS smartphone, within about 3 or 4 minutes with a pair of headphones, you'll be able to monitor and you'll be able to measure your hearing number, much like you might know your blood pressure or your weight. The hearing number is just basically how loud do speech sounds have to be for you to hear it. So if your number is 0 decibels, it means you can hear really soft sounds. And the higher the number is means the poorer your hearing is, right? You can actually track that longitudinally. And what you'll find is that everybody, beginning essentially after your teenage years, everybody's hearing, if you monitor that number, monotonically declines bit by bit by bit by bit over your lifetime.
Wow.
Right? So the term hearing loss is arbitrary. We say arbitrarily, if you look at a 20 decibel cutoff, that roughly about 20% of the population, of the US population, actually has that level, right?
Wow.
Right? And you'll be able to track it over your life course, right? Much like any other metric. And the reason why that's so important is that if we have, now we understand hearing is so important for health. At the same time, a few years ago, we got a law passed in Congress after many years of work with the White House and Senators Warren and Grassley that are now making hearing aids over the counter in the United States. So now you're seeing the tip of the iceberg of increasing innovation from companies like Bose, eventually comes like Samsung, maybe even Apple, things like that. They're innovating in the OTC hearing aid space. So you have wonderful evidence that hearing is important. We now, in the next couple of years, we'll see this increasing innovation with OTC hearing aids that anyone can buy for a lot less expensive. But the fundamental barrier, though, is that if no one even knows what their hearing is, right? And I'm guessing a lot of the listeners on your call right now or this podcast, The last time anyone got their hearing checked or tested was probably back when you're 7 years old in primary school.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
And it doesn't really matter, right? Mm-hmm. So this initiative now is leveraging essentially existing digital technologies to push all Americans, beginning as a teenager, on your smartphone in 4 minutes to just learn your hearing number and go to track it over your life course. If you know your hearing number, it can guide you to whether or not you may be experiencing problems that you may have unnoticed. And it can guide you then to adopting the right technology and strategies to allow you to hear better.
Where do you see the future of hearing?
So this is really cool, Dean. I think this is really exciting. Hearing aids are so expensive, right? Like $3,000 to $4,000 for a pair of hearing aids. Like, what are you talking about, right? Part of that was because how they're regulated in the past. The only way you could sell a hearing aid is through a licensed provider, through an ENT or an audiologist. And those laws, those FDA regulations, made sense 45 years ago because the only way for a hearing aid to be safe with the technology of 1977 was it had to be given to a licensed provider. Mm-hmm. You had to manually tune them with a screwdriver. I'm not joking. Those laws never kept up until just recently. We got a law passed in Congress a few years ago that was just enacted a year and a half ago now, which is re-regulating hearing aids to allow them to go over the counter. So that's why in the last year, all of a sudden you're seeing companies like Bose, Jabra enter the OTC hearing market. There's a lot more innovation. Now, because of that, we are just seeing the tip now of the innovation that is going to be coming from some of the big tech companies. They're already making, you know, high quality wireless earbuds that we all know about. The idea that those could be converted and essentially will be the same as an OTC hearing aid makes it very, very powerful. And I'll just mention just one company in particular that's already gone public, EssilorLuxottica, $27 billion per year revenue company. They own Ray-Ban, they own Oakley, they own LensCrafters. They're entering the market with, they look like completely, honestly, super cool, stylish glasses.
Yes.
Right? But because their glasses are, you know, it's bigger than a hearing aid, right? In the front of the glasses are 6 beamformer microphones. The general rule of thumb, if you're trying to pick up signal from noise, the more microphones you have and the farther apart those microphones are apart, the better you can get signal from noise. That's why a hearing aid is always very limited, because a hearing aid is sort of tiny, sits on your ear, and only 2 little microphones there. You have 6 beamformer microphones separated apart by the width of your face. It's like whoever you look at is what you hear. And the reason why it works so well is pure the physics of signal processing. If you have more microphones, the microphones are further apart, you can extract much better signal from noise. That's one example of a technology coming to market. I think they're planning to launch end of this year in the U.S. market, only the U.S. market initially, because that's where they have a clean path to market. And it's a technology, literally, you just put it on your face and you will hear better. It's wild. So I think you're seeing that innovation only because we got that law passed in the U.S., which is allowing for the market to open up. So that's just one example. Amazing. And the future too, I think what you're gonna see too is increasingly post-microphone algorithmic processing, right?
Yes.
Creating wireless headphones that synchronize with your phone automatically, where there's much more computing power, post-processing in the smartphone directly. The third one I'll mention, which I'm really excited about too, actually, is the next generation of Bluetooth, version 5.3. It's called AuraCast. It will allow far-field sound transmission. Imagine if you're in an airport and there's a TV in the gate, but you can't hear it. You'll be able to pull your phone, and much like you pick out a Wi-Fi signal, you're going to pick out the Gate 5 TV, and then it's going to stream the Gate 5 TV sound straight to your wireless earbuds. Theaters or lecture halls I've been to where the acoustics are terrible. In the future, one simple Bluetooth transceiver dongle, you plug into the microphone, and anyone in the audience can pull their phone, pick the signal they want to listen to, and it'll stream straight to their earphones or headphones. So I think it's all converging right now, so it's a really, really exciting time.